Hello, this is Michelangelo Badio. We are live again. So I'm going to do the usual thing and just wait till everybody gets online. Hey, Cynthia, how are you? It's great to see you again. Hi, Alexis, how are you? Hi, Cynthia. Let's see, that's, I think, Byron, Jose, Brazil. I love Brazil. Let's see, Tanya. Hi, Tanya. Anthony, how are you? Patrick, how are you? Let's see who else. Now we're getting some good numbers. Caesar, how are you? Yeah, man. Yeah. Hi from Mexico. Hello. I couldn't see that name, but we have a lot of people online here. Great. Okay, well, let's, from Turkey. I love Turkey. I've been there twice. Jason, hey, how are you? Let's see. Who else? I see Alexis again. Okay. Anyway, well, let's start playing a little bit. Now, what I'm using today is my ES hybrid series. And a lot of people have been asking me about this 40-watt amp and what does the clean sound sound like? Hello, Melissa, how are you? Yeah, a lot of people online now. Okay, great. So I want to just show you. I'm going to switch back and forth. I'm going to use the ES hybrid. This guitar has 23 different sounds. And I did a really cool demo. You can go to the Sawtooth World site and see it. And also, if you download the app, the GoDPS Live app, anything you buy off the app is 20% off, and the app is absolutely free. Plus, you can see the MAB band in concert. But anyway, watch. Now, this is the clean channel of the 40-watt amp. Now, I have it set in humbucker mode. So you are hearing the neck position of the humbucker. Now what I have is I have my signature delay. You can see that little blue light through the effects loop. So there's an effects loop and there's built-in reverb. And it's a Celestion speaker, vintage 30. It's beautiful. This is a really high-end, great-sounding 40-watt tube amp. Watch. Now that is the humbucker side. Now watch. Now here is the single coil. You hear how it's got that really crystal sound. Now that it's got a five position, so it... You can hear how great this clean sound is on the 40 watt. Now, what I do, I've talked about this before, these humbucker pickups, you can see it up close. The humbucker pickups are inherently louder. They just are, they're humbuckers. So the output is louder. In order for us to keep the integrity of the guitar, we made the humbuckers, the sound of and volume of a normal humbucker, and the single coils the same. So what I did is, and my pedal board, I hooked up a compressor. And what the compressor does, it will keep the range of the humbucker and it boosts the single coil and it levels off the humbucker so you get the same volume. Watch, I'm gonna switch back and forth from the humbucker to the clean single coil. This is single coil. Now it is the neck position. See how much warmer that humbucker is? I mean, it's more, what do you think jazz players use humbuckers? I mean, but if you want that bright, then you have that single coil. And you can use all those positions like got such a great sound. This is a true hybrid guitar. There's really no guitar on the market like it, except for the ET hybrid, which has got Tele pickups, dude. See, I'm trying to subdue Joey this week. I'm the star! Wait! I am the star of this show. It is Joey, and MAB is the co-host. Joey is the star. See what I mean? Yeah. So anyway, I'm trying to subdue Joey and say, Joey, play some nice chords, will you? Don't just shred. And he's like, I hate this. I hate this. I hate that even more. Oh, I love you. I love you. Oh, I love you. That. But I make him do it. Why? Because the chair is so sophisticated. And you see, I'm a jazz enthusiast. Anything other than jazz is just below my musical dignity. Unless it's jazz, I just think it's so trivial. So trivial. I love these slash chords. You know, you hear these ethereal chords like Steely Dan, right? It took Styx. They said, jazz cards? We're gonna turn it into a rock song. See, Joey likes that. Now, but anyway, when you hear this song, see, it's that really, you know, elastic, stratty sound. If you play this guitar and plug in a regular Strat, forget the hybrid part of it, this is gonna be right there. Then you have that humbucker, and I'm going to click it to overdrive. I'm going to switch back and forth. This amp is really amazing. It really is fantastic, and I used Sawtooth in 2020 before COVID hit. I did more shows in that limited amount of time, January and all of February, than I have in a long time. I tied my all-time record of over, I think it was 21 shows in 21 days, or 24 shows. I have to look at it, but it was a lot. And I used Sawtooth amps. I never had a problem with them. They were great. But I didn't have this one. Now watch, this is the clean sound. Now here's the out of phase. The middle position. Then you have that other out of phase. And then, I love that song. And then you have the bridge. And then you have the humbucker. Now I'm in humbucker mode. This is bridge. I'm sorry, not bridge. It's neck position. And then lastly, the bridge. I'm going to switch it back and forth to overdriver. This is the 40 watt bad boy. Now watch, it's got a foot switch. You're going to see me start. Yeah! Now watch. Humbucker mellow. there's so many different tones to this guitar. I'm gonna just switch it back and forth. Now I am in single coil mode. I'm going to use the bridge position in single coil mode. Sounds great. I mean, we achieved it. We did it. You know, everybody said, "Oh, you're gonna put Beagles and Clues together, Beagles. You're going to get phase." Like, I'm gonna make up something. You're going to get phase oscillation. What are you talking about? I don't care what you're talking about. It don't matter. You know, this is why I always love the pundits. They, you know, it's like, wear the mask. Don't wear the mask. Wear two masks. Wear three masks. Wear no mask. We're one mask. Well, who are all these experts anyway? You know, are they actually out there doing it? You know, who are the experts? And so, you know, who are these pundits? You know, that the prognosticate and say all this stuff. It's like, oh, it's just jazz. It's only jazz. Everything is beneath me. It's like, oh, don't even bother me with, oh, steal it on a fusion. Fusion is what? A combination? What does it fuse? Like a fuse is in an amp, a fuse. And so you have a lot of people that say you can't do these things. Well, a bunch of people told us this is impossible to do, because you can't put pickups that close together. Guess what? We did it. Not only does it work, but it works really good. I mean, I love these guitars. And then you add one extra thing, the top of the line, bad boy, German-made Floyd Rose! Yes! How long can I keep my mouth open? Was in single coil mode. In humbucker mode, it's death! World War III! Gets really crazy is when you combine all these things. It's like, okay, I've been playing one or the other. Watch. And then, humbucker. Single coil. But then when you start combining both, you get the girth of the humbucker. That on any other guitar but this one. It's a combination of humbuckers and single coil. Now, the premise of this lesson today is how I got signed to two major labels. You know, I want to talk about one. Hey, Bill, I see Bill Peck online. Matthew, hey, we have Bombs Away, of course. I love a good dive bomb. Who doesn't? Dimebag liked it. If it was good enough for Dive, it's good enough for MAB. And so all I can tell you is this. when I grew up, what I found out, I'm a student of history. I love music history. I love world history. I love reading about, I have all this memorabilia in my house. You know, my family, I showed you guys a couple weeks ago, you know, well, a tour of my home with all these things. You know, I have artists. My great-great-grandfather was an artist. And so, you know, if you have artistic ability in any capacity, whether it's musical or drawing or whatever, I mean, you know, my dad used to have a funny saying that the acorn doesn't fall far from the tree, which means that you are a product of the of your family and generations past. And so, what I did realize about just music in general is that when you look at timelines of people who made it big, usually there's a cluster of people in that area that have made it big together. And I'm going to give you a great example. Peter Frampton, if you know anything about him now, a lot of young people know. Hearing the 40 watt amp exclusively. Clean sound. Overdrive, and I'm using the foot switch just to bounce back and forth. I've got my signature delay hooked up, and I've got an overdriver that I turn on sometimes when I use the overdrive channel, depending if I want the metal death sound. But getting back to this, Peter Frampton went to school with David Bowie. Okay, a lot of people don't know that, but and he was his real name was David Jones. And so when you think about, you know, okay, and then you have, you know, bands like the Beatles, and who came up in the Beatles era, the Rolling Stones. These were all British bands. Usually when you find one, you find a cluster. And what I mean by that, think of the Seattle grunge scene. When you think of when Nirvana hit, it wasn't just Nirvana in Seattle. It was Stone Temple Pilots. It was Alice in Chains. It was Soundgarden. It was a scene. And that scene has a tendency to not only provide and showcase one artist, but several usually end up making it. Well, I had a similar situation when I was growing up. I want you guys to Google a name. Adolf Schaller. A-D-O-L-F as in Adolf. Adolf. S-C-H-A-L-L-E-R. We are the exact same age. He was my best friend growing up, and I talked about him recently. He is an award-winning space artist. This guy, I'm a very good artist. I have the ability to draw just like my ancestors. I can, but I was really good at caricatures and really funny stuff. And this has a lot to do with about why I got signed. Adolf and I, at 10 years old, I started playing guitar. He played accordion and drums. Now I played piano, but you know, what we used to do is we would draw, we would sit together, like usually we went to his house because he had the drum set there. So my mom would drop us off. We'd sit in his room and we would draw pictures. And I would draw really hysterical stuff. I mean, you know, I have a crazy sense of humor, and I would draw these funny caricatures. We'd just crack up and laugh. Then we would go down in the basement and play music. He'd play drums, I'd play guitar. Then we would go outside and play dodgeball. But it wasn't called dodgeball then. It was called bombardment. That is a meaner name. Kids nowadays do not know the meaning of trying to kill your opponent in school. I love bombardment. We used to sit and play. We would play at my parents' house. We'd play it at school. This game was to the death. We were seriously trying to hurt each other. And I loved it. And we didn't play with the normal balls you use with dodgeballs. We used soccer balls. Don't ask me why. Okay, it's kind of like soccer or like a softball in Chicago. They use a 16-inch soft ball where normal softball is 12-inch. Chicago is just weird. So anyway, Adolf and I used to play bombardment and try to kill each other. Then we would play music together. Then we would draw. And one of the things, I had a musical epiphany, like Tom Morello had told me when I gave him lessons. He actually told me, he said, Michael, your lessons were a musical epiphany. It changed his life. And I was very grateful that he said that. And he's been very vocal and very public about that I taught him, even on Howard Stern recently, but it's in magazines. It's corroborated, and he says the same story over and over because it's all true. You know, you don't have to remember the truth. The truth is the truth. But here's where I'm coming up with Adolf. When we were drawing one time, he showed me a pencil sketch of a lunar landscape that was so amazing. We were kids. We were 10, 11 years old. And then we played together from 10 to 12. Then my parents moved to another location, and I really never saw Adolf again. We didn't keep in touch with our kids, you know? But what happened was, when I saw Adolf's lunar landscape, I said to myself, this guy, it looked like you were walking, it looked like you were looking at a picture of the moon. It was so good. And I said, you know, I'm better in music than he is. You know, I have more talent. Like, I'm a really good artist, but it wasn't where my heart was. Where Adolf's heart was in his art, my heart was in my music. And the thing is, though, but again, this idea of that a scene makes it. Adolf became a really famous artist, really famous. And I Googled him just today, just to look at even more of his paintings. And I mean, he's absolutely fantastic. And you know, here's a guy that we were best friends growing up. We were inseparable, and we had these three things in common. We wanted to kill each other with bombardment. We loved to jam and music. And we loved to draw together. We would just sit in this room and draw. And I would draw. I'm a really good artist. And I would draw these hilariously funny things and really nicely and shaded. But then when he started drawing these lunar landscapes and planets, obviously hindsight's 20/20, but that's what he became, basically a space artist. He is an award-winning artist. And I mean, he's a really famous artist in this realm of, if you give him coordinates and say, we think the planet Neptune looks like this, he'll paint it. And that's what he did. It's really incredible. Now, why am I saying that? Because what got me signed was this. I always knew I was going to be, I'm going to just say it right out. I knew I was going to be a known guitar player. I love that clean sound. I love it. Now, I'm actually in the hybrid mode. I'm in the humbucker and the single coil. Your single coil. Yes. Now, I'm in the bridge position of both. Listen, humbucker, single coil. Now, together. Do you hear how you get both of them? You get the girth of the humbucker, and you get the brightness and twang. Of the single coil. Now, getting back to getting signed, I was in a band, and we're releasing a video real soon. I'm going to talk about this in the live stream too. But we were on trimesters at that time at Northeastern University, which means three segments per year, not semesters, which are two. We were not trimesters. So my last trimester of school, which was at the time, you know, because they did take a break, but it was basically August through, you know, December. And I joined a band in my last year of college called Freeze. And we are releasing a video this Saturday at 2 p.m. from the old Freeze. It's pretty amazing. And I'll go into that a little bit more depth. But after I played in this band Freeze, we broke up. I was in another band for a while called U.S., and then I moved to Los Angeles. Within 1 year, I got signed. I went through five or six different bands. I saw people that were perfectly straight, and then 3 months later were addicted to cocaine. I saw I morphed from Mike Badio, Midwestern kid. I could have been a Geico salesman, to Michelangelo Badio rock star. And I, you know, I was just hanging out with people that, that looked like rock stars, that played great. And I ended up in within 1 year of joining the band Holland, and we got signed to a major label. And I remember, this is why I have a low tolerance for people who talk trash online, you know, whether it's about me or about music, because the manager in Holland went on to manage Enough's Enough, and then he went on to do really great things. I mean, Paul McCartney was at his wedding, so, you know, this guy was a mover and a shaker in the industry. But he asked me one time, he goes, Mike, he goes, have you ever been signed to a major label? Now, at this time, when I was in Holland, I wasn't. I said, no. And he said it basically like this. He goes, why don't you shut up and learn something? And he was right. You know, I thought about it because I don't like the fact that he was kind of rude to me. But I said, you know what? His name is Bob. I'm not going to say his last name right now, but Bob was right. He was absolutely right. Well, I'll tell you his last name, Brigham, Bob Brigham. And he was the manager of Tom Holland and the band, from the band Holland, in a band before that called the Bees. Stephen Riley from that band was the drummer in Wasp and then L.A. Guns. So it's a very close-knit musical circle. Again, groups of people end up making it at the same time. You know, it's just the way life is. You know, Bill Gates and Steve Jobs went to school together. Why is it so shocking? You know, I mean, this happens all the time. And so, anyway, when I got signed with Holland, I learned so much about the industry. I mean, I learned, for example, we did a great record. I mean, I had riffs like... Sacrifice for love. Sacrifice for love. Sacrifice for love. In fact, that was one of the songs that got us signed. And then I came up with this other riff going. Wake up the neighborhood. Wake up the neighborhood. Wake up the neighborhood. Wake up the neighborhood. These are ripping songs, man. I had all those riffs, and that's why we got signed. The lead singer, Holland, I came up with this one. And Joey's like, yes, 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 yes. About 2 minutes later, Holland goes, wake up the neighborhood. That's what we called it, wake up the neighborhood. There's a movie called Girls Just Want to Have Fun. And in that movie, we have the main song. Sarah Jessica Parker's in that. Helen Hunt, Shannon Doherty, Jonathan Silverman. All these big stars, when they were really young, were in this movie, and we had the main song. When I was in my mid-20s, I mean, I'm a year out of college, that album was released on Polygram Records, which is a major label, the soundtrack to the movie. Our record comes on at Atlantic. I was on two major labels in 1 year. Now, before that, I was on Shrapnel Records with Mike Varney, but I was still living at home, and I was playing in the band US. I had graduated college, but I hadn't quite moved to LA yet. Who was on Shrapnel? Yngwie Malmsteen, John Five, Marty Friedman, Greg Howe, Vinnie Moore. Vinnie Vincent! Wake it up. Anyway, Vinnie Moore. You know, I love that song. And Vinnie's a good friend. But, you know, Greg Howe. I mean, the Tony McAlpine. The list goes on and on and on. Shrapnel Records was the label that was like a badge of honor to be on. That was my first label, and that was when I was still living at home. But I had the things that got me signed. One, the music is always first. So regardless, the music is first. But when I lived in LA, I learned something about living in Hollywood. Image goes a long way. I mean, John 5 is really amazing, and Buckethead is really amazing, but what if they just dressed in flannel shirts and jeans like Kurt Cobain? You know, I mean, how amazing is that? You know, is their music so amazing that it's going to carry them over? That's a question only the public can answer. But because they have this extreme image, that enhances what they do. It's like me with the double guitar when Sebastian Bach said, "Dude, like your image was extreme, bro. It was like, I watched you on MTV, bro. That was like extreme." He goes, "But man, when I saw you on that metal show, it's like I jumped out of bed and said, you have talent." He actually, Sebastian told me this. We were on the Monsters of Rock cruise. And he said he was in bed, you know, sleeping, he's married, you know. And he said he got out of bed and put it at the TV. It's like, that mofo's got a lot of talent, and meaning me. And we talked for a long time on the cruise. I like him, you know. He's very outspoken, but hey, you know, he's earned it. You know, he's big. He can say what he wants, you know. You don't have to agree with him, but, you know, I respect that he says it. And so, but the point is this, that I had what it took in the first major label experience. I had the drive. I was in the right place at the right time. I worked on my music, and I started cultivating my image. Now, my image wasn't 100% together when I was in Holland, because the name Holland was the name of the lead singer, Tom Holland. And it's not Spider-Man, but Tommy Holland. And he was a fantastic singer. He still is. And he's a really, you know, he's still a great friend, but a great songwriter, great frontman. I mean, really, he had all the things going, and we were all young. You know, I mean, our drummer was 21 in Holland, Brad Rorson, you know, so we had a young band. But, you know, we did a great record, but we didn't achieve the success that I thought we would achieve with the record. That's that hybrid mode, humbuckers. Now, what I have is I have the neck position pickup on both the single coil and the humbucker. Now here's humbucker. Here's strap. Now watch. Now here's where it gets crazy. I've got the neck position on the single coil, but the bridge position on the humbucker. And I've got this in dual. Now see, here's where it would be in humbucker. Yeah. Now here's together. Three different sounds on the ES hybrid. Okay, now getting back to this major label, I had to do that. One of the things that I learned, being on a major label, we did shows with Aerosmith, we toured with them, big places, big, they called them sheds, you know, outdoor venues, 25,000 seats. And there's a lot of things. I was treated actually really badly in the band. You know, even though I was the main songwriter with the singer, and it was his band, him and the manager called the shots, but I didn't make hardly any money. I'm going to tell you how much I made. We got $125,000 advance from Atlantic. You know how much I got? The entire record, $250. Now, I've had a... Before I moved to LA, when I was home, I'm not saying I'm so wonderful. I paid for my own college tuition. I was a session guitar player. I made really good money. And you know, I taught guitar. I did sessions, TV commercials. So I had already established credit. I had a Gold American Express even back then. And it's not like people were, you know, I'm so wonderful that I'm the smartest guy in the world. I worked really hard. And then here I joined Holland. And you know, I'm not making any money. My parents helped me out. Thank God my dad was doing well at the time. I couldn't pay my credit card bills. I had no money for anything. And you know what? I didn't even care because I just loved it so much. I loved the music of the band. I loved hanging out. And I was a nutcase. I'm in LA going, I'm in Southern California and it's nice outside in December. Yes. And then we had to do this thing. It was hilarious. In the Van Hall, we were living in this beautiful house in La Habra Heights. Awesome. And they had a pool, but they had a glass door going out to the pool, and the way it shone, the way the sun like hit it, you couldn't tell if the door was open or closed. And we used to like, boing, we used to walk into it so much. I'd be like walking, going out the pool, a clunk, ow! Joey's like, you stupid idiot. I'm the stardust. Let me guide you. So Joey wanted to actually walk in front. And so I couldn't even see this thing. And finally I had this, I had a structural epiphany. What I did is we took gaffer tape and we put a big square where our heads were so we wouldn't walk into the glass door going out of the pool. Yes, we're like really intelligent rockers, bro. And so anyway, this was my first major label experience. Now I'm in L. I leave the band. I had to leave the band. It just wasn't for me anymore. The music wasn't, you know, I mean, just everything, it didn't feel right. And I had to leave. And so when I left, they replaced me with a really great guitarist named Alex Kane. He's still a really good friend. And Manny Alvarez, I think he's a professional tech right now. But anyway, what I did was I started a band called the Michelangelo Band. We were amazing. And then that band morphed into, I met Jim Gillette, and then Jim Gillette and I, all the labels were interested in us. And again, we focused on one thing, the music first. I came up with this riff. I had the idea, literally, I mean, really, I had the basic idea from Richie Blackmore. But I came up with this, and I've said this before, I am Machine Gun Eddie. Machine Gun Eddie, I also had this part. I had the intro. But then I had this part too. I'll take you higher. And that diminished chord, it was really cool. Like, and then and the same thing happened in Nitro that happened in Holland. I would come up with these riffs, like this one that we called Freight Train. I had it, I called it Believe in Yourself. Believe in Yourself. And Jim was like, believe in yourself. Joey's like, that's stupid. And so, you know, I never said I was a lyricist. I never said I was Shakespeare. But I can write really cool riffs. And so, and it took like 2 seconds. And me, you know, when I showed Jim, I said, yeah. He was like, well, dude, what do you call it, man? I like, well, I call it believe in yourself. And he starts laughing. And he's like, really? And he starts laughing. And I played it like... And all of a sudden, like a freight train. And then he starts singing, the tell me what to do. He just started singing this thing. And the song created itself, just like Machine Gunetti. I have this part that... these evil parts, and all of a sudden Jim starts singing like, he goes like this, I'll take you higher, I'll take you higher, and then you go, machine girl, he just had this knack for the hook. Just like Tom Holland, they knew how to write hooks. And so we had the music first, but in Nitro, we did something way different than Holland. We worked as hard on the wildest look that Holland never really worked on. And not the band as a whole. We had a cool look because we were young, but we didn't really think Hollywood, where Jim and I, you know, Jim was a kid. You know, I met him when he was 17. He wrote Proud to Be Loud when he was 19. We recorded the first album when he was 19 years old. And he had this really, you know, he was really handsome guy and an athlete. So he had that chiseled body. We worked on our image. But when we played one show at Gazzari's on the Strip, they used to be the Key Club. It's right next to the Bow. It's closed now for a long time. Bill Gazzari. But when we played there, we got signed. I mean, Jim shattered glass with his voice. And unfortunately, a lot of times when you shatter glasses, sometimes they explode, but sometimes it's very unspectacular. So Jim actually went, ah! But we were expecting the glass to break like rehearsal. It didn't. It was like a limp, you know what? It was. It was like very, very anticlimactic. And so what happened was the glass just went clink, and it stood there. It cracked. It split, but it didn't fall. And then it went clink. And Jim and I are looking at it like, really? Okay. And Gazzari's was like packed to the rafters. It was like the limp weenie starting the show because it's like, wah! We were expecting splat, glass everywhere, shattered in your face. Except what happened was, yeah, it broke all right. Everybody's like, what just happened? Yeah, like, did it break? Did he do it? Did he really do it? And we were looking at each other like, you know, like, just let me hit it. Let me do something. Like, even on the freight train video, it splattered. But we found out just from experience, and I can go through the how to break the glass. But Jim had, he could hold a note for 30 seconds, so he could do it. But the point was, it was very anticlimactic, very unspectacular. Any adjective you can think of for nada. It was nada happening. And so anyway, then we started the show, but we got signed. One show, we got signed. And the thing that we did was we had the elements. You know, because a lot of times when a guitar, and a lot of things haven't changed in the industry now. I just, believe it or not, I was online a few weeks ago watching a seminar of, you'll love this, forensic musicology. And it was the top entertainment, a top attorney on planet Earth that does copyright infringement cases. If you know the song Blurred Lines, they got sued by the Marvin Gaye family, and he represented Marvin Gaye on this. And we talked about Spotify, about a lot of things. But one of the things that, you know, I really took out of this interaction and learning, you know, I'm always a student, is that you have to keep up with what's going on. But some things, it's good to know the past, because then you don't make the same mistakes of the past. But this, the future in music right now is so different than it ever was when I was growing up. And that's why I'm still, I'll use the word relevant, because I'm online right now. I mean, I never had the opportunity to do this coming up in the music industry. You know, my idea growing up, and the reason I got signed was back then, is because we concentrated on the music first, and especially in Nitro, our image. We had an extreme image that just made you, we brought you in and made you want to look at us. Also, Tom Holland was, I love Tom Holland's voice in the band Holland. I used to get chills listening to him. I loved being the guitarist with Holland. I had no problem being the second guy with the lead singer. A lot of times the lead singers have problems with the second guy. And that's a weird thing to say, but it's true. The ego of the singer far outweighs, in many times, the ego of the guitar player. Not all the time, but a lot of times. Most bands break up because of the lead singer, not because the guitars. And you know, I'm not saying, you know, it's 100%, there's nothing, but it's just a lot of times just that happens. And so, anyway, let me, okay. Okay, this shut off here. Do I have it on standby? Anyway, but all I can say is this, that what gave me the opportunity to get signed was the music, and then we worked on the extra things, the image, and also Jim was really good at the communication level, talking to the people. That's another thing I learned, that we were really good at butting up to everybody, that we would engage the president of our record company, we would engage the you know, we would just BS with them, we'd hang out with them. We dropped sacks of fan mail trying to get more money for our second album. That actually helped work. But let's fast forward it to today, because I'm going to just take a couple more minutes. And in today's world, what do we have? The major labels are still there in a big way. The major labels control more than you think. And so you think it's easy to get on Spotify and these big on these big playlists? You think it's easy to get billions of views? Normally, you have to be on these major labels because they are the movers and the shakers. And the record industry is thriving right now. Young artists are better now than they've ever been. And so what I've learned, if anything, is that, you know, the old philosophical concept, the only constant is change, is always true. You either change with the times or you get behind the times. You have no choice. But there are people who are ahead, are the proactive ones. And see, for example, this show, right when COVID started to hit, I didn't know that everything would be canceled, but immediately I shifted to online. We're approaching my 50th show. I've been online almost a year. And so one of the things that I learned from all this is that things still don't change. You still need great songs, and you still need some kind of an image to resonate with people to portray that music. So what do you do now? You know, when people ask me, well, Michael, you know, what suggestions would you have? Work on your music and release it. Release it online, because see, the artist has more control now today than they've ever had. I had no control over what a magazine could write about me. And if they wrote something I didn't like, which happened, not ever in Holland. People always loved me in Holland. But when I really put it out there with four guitars and an extreme image with Nitro, I got to be a subject. Some, you know, sometimes people really flame me, and our label loved it. Jim loved it. And Gillette. And because when you put yourself out there, you know that if you're doing something right, people will watch. You will resonate with them. And also know, if you get some haters, you're right in there with Kiss and David Bowie and Frank Sinatra and Mozart and Paganini and Beethoven and the Beatles and Linkin Park and Nirvana. That everybody that's made it big has to, you can never get 100%. So if I had any advice for the people listening, if you're trying to make it a music, one, create your music. Two, express your music online. Work on your social media. I have good social media numbers. But I've also come from the touring background. So this wasn't a normal thing for me to just go online all the time and do all these things online. It was something that wasn't really second nature to me. You know, touring, then you get off tour. You know, I actually got to look decent. I had to figure out why my face was so red week after week. Was it the light? I don't know. Was it the lighting? Maybe it was the lighting. I can't tell. You know, and so, you know, I had to figure this stuff out. And you know, it's I had a red light in the background that's shining on my face. And so what I had to do was, you know, it's a learning experience, but we all learn. And go online, put your music out there, put yourself out there. You have more control now than you ever have. When has the average person ever had a voice in what happens? Yeah, you know, the mob rules. You know, enough people get together and form, you know, a protest. That's one thing. But actually to have your voice online, to be heard, an individual voice, is something that we really as humans have never had before. So it's a brave new world. And so that's why I can't say enough about the technology. I mean, even the technology about these hybrid guitars. I have a saying, you can't think outside the box unless you know what's in the box. I know what's in the box. I've lived in the box. I didn't like the box all the time. Sometimes I did, it's comfortable, but sometimes I didn't like it. Joey didn't like it. I'm still the star. Forget what he's talking about. It's me, I, me. Joey the narcissist. Now, I'm not a ventriloquist, okay? I'm not professing to be a ventriloquist. Joey has to speak through me, but he takes control. Yes, see what I mean? I can't help it. In the middle of the night, Joey, shut up. Wake up and go to sleep. I feel like I'm living with the Three Stooges. See, Robert will just go, he'll just hit me in the head. Like, what? He'll be like, what? And I'm like, and he does this like a dog wanting to go out. It's like, idea. I got an idea in my head. I got an idea. Idea. This is like the world's angriest dog. He says nothing. He is so angry, he cannot say a word. He's just angry. He uses the pick as an expression of the anger that is within him. So I'll be laying there about like, what? And I'm like, and so it's the signal, turn on the iPhone record. And I'll be like, you know, I don't know what happened. But anyway, all of a sudden, I will play a riff and I'll record it. I have hundreds of riffs in my phone. And Michael Amott said, you know, we were talking about that. He goes, dude, why don't you like, well, he doesn't say dude, because I just lived in California so long. But he's like, well, why don't you record video? That way you don't have to relearn it. I'm like, duh. So I record video sometimes. So I got Robert waking me up, hit me, and Joey just like, what do you think? Why do you think I play two guitars at the same time? So I'm thinking about Del Taco and Taco Bell. Joey's thinking he's the star. And Robert's like, yes, yes, yes. And then he gets to actually finger notes too, which is something different for him. So it's kind of like doing weights and cardio. So anyway, I just want to say this. I got signed. You know, nobody. Yeah, Elvis is the man. I loved Elvis. I saw Elvis. My mother took me to see Elvis. Why is somebody writing about Elvis as the man? Hey, Jake, take a cool off the medication there a little bit. Elvis rocks. We all know that. I don't know what it has to do about this thing, but I love Elvis too. I was in Tupelo. I saw where he was born. I also saw Graceland, and I also saw Elvis in concert when he was really thin. Before he gained weight, he was amazing. And my mom took me to see him. My sister wouldn't go. And somebody's writing Elvis all over the place. So I figured I would respond. But I love Elvis. You know, I love a lot of artists. The thing that Elvis could do that he doesn't get maybe as much credit for, although he gets a lot of credit, he could sing low. He could sing high. He could sing raspy. He could sing clean. He could sing a ballad. He could sing rock. He could sing Latin music. He could sing blues. He grew up singing gospel in the church, you know? And he was super poor. I mean, ridiculously poor. And he was actually born an identical, there was an identical twin. He was also had blonde hair, but his twin brother died. I don't know if it was at childbirth or shortly after, but his mom said an interesting thing to him that all the power of the brother went into him, you know. And but I think his mom had a huge influence on him. I mean, Elvis was just, you know, he was you can't really, it's like a McCartney. How do you, it's beyond the scope of like a superstar. It's a phenomenon. That's the word I was looking for. It's a phenomenon. Elvis was a phenomenon. McCartney and the Beatles were a phenomenon. It goes beyond a song. They changed events. In many ways, even people like Eddie Van Halen were a phenomenon, or Hendrix. They changed the way guitar was made. Even in many ways, Yngwie Malmsteen, you know, when he came out, he changed the way guitar was thought of with Baroque music. I mean, that's a phenomenal thing to do. And I'm not saying it's on the level of an Elvis or a McCartney and the Beatles, but it's phenomenal. And you know, that's why I've always enjoyed Yngwie. I like him. You know, I've met him before. We're not best friends or anything, but I, you know, it's pretty incredible. Getting back to this, the ES series guitars are great. If you have any doubts about what to do in today's world, record your music, record your videos, go online. If you're a comedian, tell jokes, film it, post it. People like it. It's like the Wayne's World movie. You know, if we talk about it, they will come. If you are really good, they will come to you. You know, I happen to have a way about me that gravitated towards people. I connect with people because I genuinely care about my lessons, but I care about my music. And regardless of what anybody says about the flamboyance of what I play, the music stands up. You know, if somebody says, well, MAB can't write a song, what about No Boundaries? Pretty well-known song. You know, what about songs like Gotta Run, my early rock days? Those, I got signed to two major labels. We got signed for our songwriting, not just because, you know, you had to write your own songs then. And so, you know, it's why I don't really like to hear a lot of prognosticators, because my first question when I hear people spouting off is, well, what gives you, you know, this exalted opinion? What makes your opinion, are you Eddie Van Halen? Have you toured? You know, are you Yngwie? Are you Steve Vai? You know, and that doesn't mean that everybody's opinion doesn't matter, but when people spout off things that are obviously not true, it doesn't make me mad, but I don't listen to it. You know, and that's the thing that I wanted to impart on this, that I got signed to two major labels because I did the right things, and I'm relevant now because, and that is the word, you've got to stay relevant, because I do the things that enable me online to keep out there until we tour again. But anyway, I just want to say this. I really appreciate this show every week. I love every second of it. We've done a lot of shows already. I'm releasing a really cool video this Saturday of the band Freeze that I was in when I was in my last trimester of college. On through the very first part of my life after school. And we released a song that was written by Mark McNally, the guitar player. And what happened was we had a cassette recording of it that sounded so good. This engineer that we call MMM, he digitized it, and it was a perfect, unglitchy recording. And so we actually sang, and I played a guitar solo to the old recording when we were 23 years old. And so the recording was when we were 23. It was a guitar solo played now using this guitar. And we had all the band members come out and play to the song. And you can see pictures of us, see video of us the way we look now and what we look like back then. Anyway, I'm Michelangelo Badio, 2 p.m. on YouTube this Saturday. Also, Sawtooth guitars are available in Canada now. Go to Amazon.com. If you're from Canada and you want to get Sawtooth, we are available. We're working on getting guitars everywhere. But, you know, the United States is covered. But now Canada is covered. Anyway, thank you very much. I'm Michelangelo Badio. Good night.